Good morning. It's 11 o'clock and I call the Saline County Commission public forum and meeting to order. Will everyone join me in a pledge of allegiance and a moment of silence?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Will the clerk call the roll?
Commissioner Shedwick.
Here.
Commissioner Guile.
Here.
Commissioner Price.
Here.
Commissioner Larson.
Here.
And Commissioner Smith.
Here.
As always, we start our meetings with the public forum, and as always, I'd like to remind people that it's open to anyone to talk about things that are not on the agenda today and is limited to 3 minutes. Is there anyone that would like to come forward at this time?
Your name and address, please.
Joan Ratsliff, Salina, Kansas.
You're going to have to speak up.
Joan Ratsliff, Salina, Kansas. I just saw the display upstairs, and I want to thank the commission for officially recognizing the extraordinary value that county government provides to the citizens and for recognizing our employees, our public servants.
Thank you very
much. Thank you for the comment.
Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. That's a good comment.
Yeah.
Norman Mount, West Pleasant Hill Road. Your calendar was so loaded last week, so I didn't get to speak on items 1 and 5. And the issue was, why don't people show up to vote? Until we change the voting system we got in this country, people are not voting because all they do is elect people. We don't have a say in the laws that you push on us. It should be, everyone should have a say in the law. Before the white man came here, they had freedom and everybody voted. The Americans voted. So until the system changes, we've got a dictatorship in this country. It's disguised, but if you look at it.
Thank you.
I'm glad I live in America, though.
Is there anyone else that would like to come forward at this time?
Yes, good morning, Commissioners. Ray Haruska, 235 North Santa Fe. Just yesterday, I sent a letter to the Secretary of State of Kansas, Chris Kobach, and his assistant secretary, Brian Kasky, requesting surrounding the issues about the recent election and the details surrounding that. I started out as a complaint from a disenfranchised voter, which I actually feel that I was. There are many questions surrounding that event that need to be answered, and I asked the Secretary of State personally for an explanation in writing the statutory authority surrounding that event. And I think it would be helpful for the public to understand that coming from the guy at the top. So I just wanted to let you know that I did that, and when I get a response, I'll share that with you.
Thank you, Ray.
Thank you.
And Ray, we did talk to Brian Kasky, and he said he represented Chris
Kobach,
and he said that they were in agreement, isn't that correct, on their decision, and their decision was they weren't going to, on the flip of the coin, they weren't going to make a decision. It was up to our county counselor. And so he happened to come along, and he made the decision, and then we proceeded with our vote.
I imagine he still is going to respond to you.
I'm sure he
I just wanted to tell you what we came up.
He did say he would respond.
And I hope you share that with us. So.
Yeah, well, I will share it with you. And I just thought it would be helpful for the something in writing based on the guidelines and the rules and the law.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else that would like to come forward at this time? Seeing none, we'll move to item number one.
It's volunteer recognition by emergency management, and Hannah Stambaugh is director of emergency management.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
This is a short little slideshow presentation for you in regards to our appreciation for the volunteer firefighters within Saline County, as well as the volunteer storm spotters or amateur radio operators that our office works with. So without further ado, Kevin, would you mind, we'll just show you some pictures of some of the highlight events just to show you the work that these men and women do around our county. The things and situations that they are put into on a daily basis. Saline County has over 150 volunteer firefighters that are on duty 24/7. Not only is it just responding to calls, it's training activities. It's working on their vehicles, cleaning the stations, building new trucks for their fire stations, participating in public and presentations, participating in events within their communities, providing public education. Just as a note, the Marquette Fire District, which actually is responsible for a portion of the southwest part of Saline County, will be celebrating 50 years of service. That's a huge accomplishment for them, and we appreciate everything that they do. Our amateur radio operators, we have approximately 12 active storm spotters in Saline County. Those folks have attended trainings. They've been educated on storm development, what storms look like, what to look for. The amount of work that they do on a monthly basis and on a yearly basis for our office to help us with keeping the citizens of Saline County safe is absolutely tremendous. Not only just storms, they are also responsible for operations at the Smoky Hill River Festival every single year, as well as an annual Aries Field Day where they operate 24/7 for radio communications around the world. We just want to be able to show our appreciation for everything that they do. We love working with them. We will do anything for them because they are an extremely valuable part of everything that operates here in Saline County. So we'll just let the pictures continue, and you can just have a nice little glimpse and some of the things that they do.
I don't think we can thank these people enough. I've been out on many, many of their tours when this thing was going on, when these fires were going on, the one in Abilene, the one in Solomon, the surrounding areas along with Saline County. They all participate very big and very brutal and take care of all of us.
Absolutely.
Even in the city.
In a 911 emergency, somebody's hurt. Do we have ambulances that go out to county?
Actually,
we do that through the...
We have what we call first responders out in the county. The city of Saline is responsible for EMS services all throughout Saline County, but each one of our fire districts have what we call first responders. Mm-hmm. Most of those first responders are, well, they must be emergency medical responder certified or EMT or paramedic certified. Luckily, with the Saline Fire Department being housed in Saline, a lot of the folks that work for Saline Fire also are volunteers out in the counties. So it's great to have that robust professionalism on our volunteer departments. So
that was what I was wanting to make a point, that they are actually volunteers also.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we almost have somebody from Saline Fire Department on almost every district, I think.
I think that we do.
That's you.
Which is a plus. Mm-hmm.
Not to mention just that, but that obviously shows the professionalism of all of our departments. But then, too, you know, we've got plumbers, we've got electricians. Everybody who is a volunteer has another job as well. So it just shows the huge dedication that these folks put into the daily operations of Saline County.
And they leave their job. If something happens, they're on. This is number one.
Yep.
See them flying down the road every day.
You mean like that one that landed on the highway? Not that kind of flying.
No.
That's one of my favorite pictures. Those were pictures from Chapman, where a lot of our volunteers went and helped.
That same night was the night that Crestwood was hit and took the top out of the building in the middle.
Hannah, what is the personal liability for someone who volunteers like that?
In what aspect?
In dealing with a fire.
In dealing with the fire part of it.
If they get hurt, or is that what you're saying? If they get hurt or injured on the job?
If they get sued, somebody's really bent out of shape by what they do.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's obviously the potential for any lawsuit or anything like that to come back on the county as well. But that's where we do a lot of stuff with the Firefighters Relief Act. There's a lot of things that that will protect them from certain aspects of it. If they're doing everything in due diligence to save a life, that's certainly.
So if they get sued personally, are we going to cover that? How do we do that?
All the fire districts have their own liability insurance coverage, mm-hmm. and so that, in theory, will take care of any suits.
Mm-hmm. There's still always the possibility that a person could be sued, but as far as the fire district or the county is concerned, that's where the whole liability insurance through each district comes through.
And you notice that a lot of these trucks that you'll see here come from maybe 80 and 90 miles away mm-hmm. to fight the fires right along with us. They're a really tight-knit bunch of people in all six regions. Is that not right, Hannah?
Yes, we have six here in Saline County, and then we have also Lindsberg Fire and Marquette Fire that come up and do a portion in Saline County. We also have the city of Assyria and the city of Gypsum.
Right, and then we have the whatever they come, the six regions in the country come around from the state of Kansas comes in here also.
Yep.
I mean, if we need them, it depends on a disaster.
Yep.
You have things really tuned up.
Yep.
All right. Further comments?
Very well done.
Thank you, Hannah. Appreciate you coming by.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for the slideshow. Item number two.
Proclamation declaring May of 2015 as Older Americans Month. It's Leslie Eichelberry, Commission on Aging Director.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me here today.
Thank you, love.
May is Older Americans Month. The Commission on Aging has celebrated that since 2012, I believe. It's a national recognition, and over the years we've added more and more events. We have a new one this year, just to tell you about briefly. We are partnering with inpatient rehabilitation unit at Salina Regional for a home medical equipment drive. We have what we call a lending closet where we lend out bath benches, grab bars, things like that to seniors who can't afford them on their own. And our resources are kind of drying up on that. So we're going to have a drive on May the 2nd over at the Senior Center to see if we can get some additional equipment for that. So that's a new thing we've added. We have several drawings throughout the month, treasure hunt. Brookdale's going to come in and do care wellness assessments. We're going to participate in First Thursday Art Rush, one of our regulars is going to be showing off her counted cross-stitch pieces, which she has about 150 of them, I believe. The pool guys have organized another pool tournament. We're partnering with the sheriff's office for Operation Medicine Cabinet, where they're going to collect unused and unneeded medications to get those off the streets, or keep those off the streets, I should say. So anyway, a lot of things going on, and I do have a proclamation, or you guys have a proclamation, read that. Whereas the Saline County Commission on Aging was established by County Commission Resolution on March 12, 1974 to provide needed services for senior citizens in Saline County. And whereas Saline County includes more than 11,500 citizens age 60 and older. And whereas Saline County seniors are active community members and get into the act through volunteering, mentorship, the arts, and civic engagement. And whereas the interactions of Saline County seniors with family, friends, and neighbors across generations enrich the lives of everyone involved. And whereas Saline County, through the Saline County Commission on Aging, can ensure community members of all ages benefit from the contributions and experiences of older adults. Now, therefore, we, the Board of County Commissioners of Saline County, Kansas, do hereby proclaim May 2015 to be Older Americans Month and encourage all citizens to take time this month to engage with our more than 11,500 seniors through enjoyable and social interactions.
All right, thank you. Sounds like you've got some great events planned. So.
We do.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
Leslie, do you have a date on the safe disposal with the Sheriff's Department?
Yes, it's May the 20th, and that'll be from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m.
At where?
At the Senior Center in the dining room.
Okay.
One of the deputies comes over and they have a box and he just sits there and puts those in the box. And
I was just wondering about this the other day and I thought about calling you and here you are.
Yeah. They come over about three times a year and do that for us.
Okay,
so.
Good.
All right. Thank you very much.
Leslie, last year I was able to go out and ride with some of the volunteers when they delivered food.
Oh, for Meals on Wheels.
Uh-huh. And I want to say that you have some wonderful volunteers. Since we have volunteers we're talking about today, and some of them have been years and years, I mean over 10 years probably, that go out on these meals. And while we're here in the public, if you have some free time and you would consider being a deliver meals, they would really appreciate it.
Yes, we would.
And it's really rewarding. You get to go in and check on these people that are having a hard time, you know, that may be in need. Mm-hmm. And they need somebody to stop in and see them. So not only are you taking them food, but you're giving them that support of just a visit. And boy, how important that is, you know.
And in some cases, that's the only human contact those people
That's
have,
right.
So the delivery people.
You know, I just wanted to mention that since we're talking about volunteers, that would be a great thing to consider doing, to be a volunteer at the Senior Center.
For the working people, I know a lot of people that do it over their lunch hour.
Uh-huh.
And so it's not just for people that have time or, you know, if they're retired or don't work on certain days of the week. I have a lot of friends that have done it, and they literally take their lunch hour for that their given week to help with Meals on Wheels.
A lot of businesses will take a week, and then one employee does it one day, another employee
exactly.
the next, and so on.
Yeah, I think that's just
and
wonderful.
We couldn't do Meals on Wheels without our volunteers.
Yeah.
We really couldn't.
It's a community participation.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It really is. So.
Ready? Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
We need a motion on this, please.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we declare May of 2015 as Old American Month. Americans Month.
Older.
Older. Old. Older. There we go. I'm not old.
There a second?
I'll second it.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Item number 3.
It's a resolution 15-2168, appointment of Dan Goble to Salina Economic Development Incentives Council. If the commission wishes, I can read that resolution, or we'll turn that over to Rita for a staff report.
We'll just turn it over to Rita. Thanks.
Okay.
Okay. The term for Lloyd Davis on the Economic Development Incentive Council expired on December the 12th, 2014. And this is a request to appoint a citizen to serve on that board as a county representative. The term would be starting now through August 31st, 2016. We had 5 interest forms. They were Daniel Goble, Kirk Cusick, John Reynolds, John Rowdy Bush, Lloyd Davison, and Randy Duncan.
All right, thank you. Just the one thing I did notice on the resolution, it says Don Goble. That could be changed fairly easily. Any comments by the commission? Any public comment?
I have one candidate that I think would serve the community well. He's got a lot of experience. He's been around for a long time. And I'm sure everyone already knows him. I think Randy Duncan would serve well on this board.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further public comment? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chairman, I move Dan Goble be appointed to the Saline Economic Development Incentives Council Board.
I second that.
There is a motion and a second. Any further comment? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Passes 5-0. Item number 4.
It's RFA 146-15, a handicap accessibility grant. Again, staff report by Rita Dyster, County Administrator.
This is a request to apply for a CDBG HA grant to enable persons with accessibility limitations to live more independently in their homes. Each household served must meet CDBG low to moderate income guidelines and must be an owner-occupied household. Eligible adaptations consist of bathroom modifications, ramps, driveways, sidewalks, doorways, utility rooms, flooring, and accessory and housing units. The maximum grant per applicant is $400,000. The maximum award per household is $12,500. A multi-county application is required. Dickinson and McPherson County has expressed an interest in applying for the grant, and North Central Regional Planning Commission would be the grant manager. And I believe we have some folks here today that can probably give us a little input on the grant.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I prepared a little written statement about the grant, so I will read from that. My name is Mika Hefner, and on behalf of Independent Connection and OCCK, we would like to convey our support for the Handicapped Accessibility Grant and the North Central Regional Planning Commission's assistance with planning this block grant approval. Challenges relating to accessing quality, affordable, and accessible housing is one of the most common reasons people contact our organization, which includes accessibility modifications to current housing so people can remain in their communities rather than having to move, such as to a nursing home or a more accessible place. By seeking citizen input, not only is Independent Connection and OCCK supportive and willing to collaborate on this grant project, we are willing to work with other stakeholders as well, and most importantly, seek the overall collaborative support of the Saline County Commissioners. Additionally, we are supportive of the collaboration from Dickinson, Mitchell, and Ottawa counties. This represents commitment and a vital step in improving the housing accessibility available to people with disabilities. As has been learned repeatedly through construction projects, incorporating accessibility features, creating a more accessible built environment leads to enhanced user experiences for all who utilize the spaces, not just for people with disabilities. In this regard, we believe more quality accessible housing will lead to better housing for all. And given the increasing demographics of persons with disabilities, homes with greater accessibility and adaptability will be open to an even larger field of buyers or renters, thereby creating a competitive market advantage in the long run for communities. And so I want to thank you for your time and hopefully your support for this grant.
Thank you. Any further public comment? We did get a nice presentation by the North Central Regional Planning Commission last week, and I enjoyed that, and bring it back to the commission for further comment or action.
At what point does the county contribute to this process financially?
At what point do we?
The only expense from the county, if there should be an expense, is that we'll be responsible for environmental review and some publications, so it should be fairly limited expense.
And we'll split that with the other counties participating, correct?
That's my understanding.
Yeah, that's mine too.
Mr. Chairman, I move we authorize North Central Regional Planning Commission to apply for the CDBG
I believe that's Community Development Block Grant, HA program as recommended by staff.
I'll second that.
All right, there's a motion and a second. Further comment? All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 5-0. Item number 5.
Recommendation of bid award to purchase reflective glass beads and staff report by Mr. Neil Cable, County Engineer.
Neil, you're going to be busy here for a bit, so.
Yeah, fasten your seatbelts. This first item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on a Saline County Road and Bridge Department request to award a contract for reflective glass traffic beads. And we opened the bids on the beads on March 2nd and received two bids, pretty typical players, Swarco and Potters. Bids are pretty close, as they generally are. So the alternatives for action are to accept the bid as indicated in the staff recommendation, reject the bids and rebid, or other options as the commission sees fit. The staff recommendation is to award a contract to Potters, who is the low bidder, for $12,980. And the budget impact, the paint and beads account has a total budget amount of $90,000. That's to cover paint and beads, and paint is the next request for action, so we'll discuss that, the whole budget thing, here in a minute. That's the beads, if you want to look at them, so brought samples, so. Pass that around if you want to see them.
You don't get to keep them. They're not free samples.
It's not glitter.
I asked what that was.
Yeah, and I even brought little glued up samples of them, so.
Oh, good. I'd be interested.
I'll show you that after.
They're small diamonds.
Yeah.
Yeah. He explained to me the other day that it's that reflective. It's what causes that to reflect.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
When the headlights or lights shine on it. So I'm being educated.
This is a pretty common thing we do every year.
Yes, sir.
It's pretty simple. And so you want me to make a motion on this?
I have a question.
You have a question? Yeah.
Did you pursue the question of state coordination of this?
I did. And I can talk about it here separately or with the paint. Whichever one you want.
I don't care.
Okay. Yeah, with regards to the beads, and I'll talk separately about the paint here in a minute, but KDOT uses beads as well. They have a double drop system on their paint stripers, and that means they use a smaller bead and a larger bead. And the smaller bead is a less quality bead than what Saline County uses, but the reflectivity is caused by the larger bead. So their smaller bead is slightly cheaper than ours, but their larger bead is more expensive. Our machine doesn't do the double drop bead as you're applying the paint. It just has a single drop. So we elected to go with what gives the bead its reflectivity is its spherosity, and it's all the way from 70% spherosity to 90% or even higher. And the cost of the beads is according to how much spherosity it is. We use 80% spherosity, which gives us good retroreflectivity. We could go to a higher spherosity than 90%, but there's a cost associated with that. So bottom line is it's kind of a compromise. We use the 80% spherosity. We pay slightly more than the cheaper beads that KDOT uses. We don't pay as much as their large bead. Kind of a cobbled up explanation, I think, but it has to do with this, the way the beads are dropped into the paint on the equipment. They use a double drop that uses a small bead, and then they drop a larger bead to get the reflectivity. And we just have a single drop, and we use not as bad as their low quality bead and not as good as their high quality bead.
Thank you for looking into that.
Sure.
Wasn't that, we done that just because we were trying to see if we could buy with the state?
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to explain that.
Yes.
Commissioner Smith brought up a good point last week, so
yes,
appreciate that.
It was a very good point.
Yep.
And some things we can do, like the trucks, we can buy that way.
Correct.
And we were just going a little further, seeing whether we could purchase with them.
Yeah, and we looked into the paint as well, and I'll talk about that.
You bet.
All right, is there any public comment on this? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I move we award the bid for glass traffic beads to Potter's Industries for the amount of $12,980.
I second that.
It's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Item number 6.
Recommendation of bid award to purchase traffic paint. Again, Mr. Neil Cable.
This item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on Saline County Road and Bridge Department request to award a contract for traffic paint. And we open sealed bids for the traffic paint on March 31st. Actually, I don't know if that date's correct. I think it's the same day as we opened on the beads, but I apologize about that. We received one bid, and that was from Ennis Paint, and their total bid was $62,750. The alternatives for action are to accept the bid as indicated in the staff recommendation, reject and the bids and rebid, and other options. Staff recommends a contract for traffic paint in the amount of $62,750 be awarded to the low bidder, which was Ennis Paint, low and only bidder, which we're not real fond of that. I mean, we prefer to have multiple bidders.
But it was fairly similar to last year. I mean, so it's not, that's not, and we asked that question last week,
right.
I think.
And then with regards to Commissioner Smith asked that we look into the state contract on the paint. It's kind of interesting. We contact Kansas Department of Transportation and Kansas Turnpike Authority. Both don't bid their paint. They buy it from a sister agency, the Kansas Correctional Institute, which used to bid our paint, but they no longer do for whatever reason. We contacted the Kansas Correctional Institute and got back an email from them, and they did visit with their management, and they're authorized to offer the traffic paint at the same price that they sell to KDOT and KTA. KTA buys, as near as we can figure, about a quarter million to 300,000 gallons of paint a year, and they pay $10.27 per gallon for the paint. And our bid price was $8.30 for the yellow paint, $8.40 for the white paint. So we get the paint for about $2 a gallon less than the state does. And so and then KTA buys also their paint from the Kansas Correctional Institute. They used to bid it. Both agencies used to bid their paint, but they don't any longer. And that may have to do with internal funding between using gas tax for funding Kansas. I really don't know the reason, but KTA uses a paint similar to ours, and they're paying $8.64 per gallon. And again, that's more than we pay at our bid price. So,
they might want to piggyback with us.
Help them out a little bit, huh?
Yeah, it's if they were, if you're buying paint in the kind of quantities that KDOT and KTA are buying it, if you bid it, you would think you would get it at a cheaper price than we're paying. You know, it just the Walmart principle. But for whatever reason, they buy it from a sister agency, and they pay substantially higher. It's more complicated than that. There are different resins. Mm-hmm. Like KDOT has a fourth generation. They use a fourth generation resin in their paint. KTA uses a third generation resin. So I mean, it's like nothing is ever simple. Ours is probably the third generation resin, and it has to do with bead retention. Apparently the fourth generation resin has a better bead retention. These glass beads were dropping in the paint, apparently stick better with the fourth generation paint. So anyhow, I think our price is clearly cheaper than what the state is paying. By not bidding their paint, they pay a higher price.
Maybe we could buy it for 8 something a gallon and sell it to the state for 9, save them a dollar, and we'd make $250,000.
It might have to do with how they're funding the different agencies. So I think it's a way more complicated issue than buying paint.
I'm sorry.
I think that last week we asked what the difference was in the bids last last year
compared
to this?
Yes, I've got the history back to 93. We keep meticulous.
You bet.
So, I mean, it's...
when we had competition bids, that's what we were interested in.
Couple of 2012, the price kind of spiked, and that we paid the highest price actually in 2012, and it's come down a little bit since 2012, for whatever reason.
Neil, I think we also asked, because they were the only bid, did you follow up and call the other companies and ask them why they didn't bid?
I did not do that.
Okay, because I think you had, how many did you send out, did you tell us?
We send out, I got the list here.
Three.
Yeah, actually, Sherwin-Williams, when I look at our, historically, Ennis Paint has been the only one bidding for the last couple of years. So Sherwin-Williams hadn't, for the last 2 years, for whatever reason, hasn't bid our paint.
So it's only been two bids that we've?
Correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Before that, Sherwin-Williams had the contract for the previous 2 years.
Okay.
Do you remember what that was?
Actually, that was the two high years, 2012 and 2013.
That's what I thought.
Is more
we're
than
less
we're
right now than we were then.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's good. Thank you.
And I think I asked you where the Ennis company was from, and I believe you said they were based in Texas.
They're actually all, they do paint worldwide. Ennis, Texas was where it started, but I think their home office now is in North Carolina or somewhere.
Oh, okay. Okay.
All right, further questions? Public comment? We have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we award the bid for the traffic paint to Ennis Paint Incorporated for $59,162.50.
I'll second.
All right, motion is second. All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 5-0. Item number 7.
It's a recommendation of bid award for the Wyman Road Bridge replacement contract. Again, Mr. Neil Cable.
A little bit more money this time.
Yeah.
Neil, so.
This item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on Saline County Road and Bridge Department Engineering Division request to award a contract for the furnishing of all materials, equipment, and labor, and doing all the work, whatever kind, necessary to replace the Wyman Road Bridge over West Spring Creek. The previous Wyman Road Bridge was a pony truss with timber deck, constructed in 1910. The bridge was 15.7 feet wide with a length of 107 feet. And the bridge's narrow width presented problems for farmers moving large equipment, agricultural equipment. There were several indications where they'd run into the pony truss. And also for vehicles coming from opposite directions at the same time. Two vehicles couldn't pass on the bridge at the same time. The bridge was in advanced state of deterioration and no longer had the minimum federal required load capacity of 3 tons. Consequently, it was closed in 2007 and subsequently removed by Road and Bridge Department crew. The iron was sold for scrap, and we salvaged all the timber plank off the bridge and used it elsewhere for repairs of other bridges. In February this year, the commission voted 4-0, Commissioner Shadwick was absent on that day, to build a bridge over West Spring Creek on Wyman Road. The Wyman Road location was selected in lieu of replacing the existing deteriorated bridge on Reese Road, which is 1 mile east of Wyman Road, which had been included in the document titled Construction Program 2012 through 2029 for bridge replacement, rehabilitation, and maintenance projects and reinforced concrete culvert projects, and it was scheduled for replacement this year. Though adopted by the commission in 2012, the referenced construction program was always meant to be amendable by a majority of the vote of the commission in order to allow the county to respond to unforeseen changes in the condition of existing bridges or other changes which might require revised priorities. The first reason for selecting the Wyman Road location over the Reese Road location was due to the fact that there would be an estimated cost savings of $200,000 associated with the Wyman location versus the Reese location. This cost saving is due to the much simpler alignment of Wyman Road with respect to the Spring Creek than at the Reese Road crossing. The second reason prompting a preference for the Wyman site over the Reese site was the fact that the Wyman location is much more convenient for the majority of the residents that will be daily users of the new bridge. Upon completion of the new bridge, a new Wyman Road Bridge, the Reese Road Bridge, will be removed. This is required because the deteriorated condition of the Reese Road Bridge and the fact that its strength cannot be demonstrated to meet the minimum federal required load capacity. In addition, the existing half and half bridge on Reese Road, as it's known, is called the half and half bridge because it's half concrete and half wood. Is a notorious debris collector that has cost Saline County many thousands of dollars over the years for debris removal after storm events. The proposed new Wyman Road Bridge will have a 30-foot wide deck and 28-foot wide roadway width, and the bridge will be 120 feet long. In addition, the bottom of the proposed bridge superstructure will be approximately 18 feet above the creek flow line with piers aligned with the creek channel. Consequently, much less debris will accumulate against the bridge during storm events. Saline County Engineering did all necessary hydraulic modeling, all necessary surveying and structural design for the proposed bridge. Furthermore, road and bridge crews have already done the necessary tree clearing and grubbing. We opened bids on this for this project on March 31st at 4 p.m. And three companies submitted bids. The low bidder was King Construction at $356,245. The low bid does not exceed the engineer's estimate, and contract may, if deemed appropriate by the commission, be awarded according to Kansas statutes annotated 68-521. So the alternatives for action today are to accept the staff recommendation, reject all bids and rebid, or other options, and the staff recommendation is to award a contract for the Wyman Road Bridge replacement over West Spring Creek to the low bidder King Construction Company for $356,245. We will be using the federal fund exchange dollars for this project, as the commission voted unanimously on February 24th to do so. And I think that's about it.
All right, questions to staff?
I think this is a good project. From driving out there and seeing where all the population was, I think it'll help a whole lot with the people out there in that area. I've had comments about how great it might be, and to see that you've done a 30-foot bridge, that's great too. It'd be a whole lot like Link Road.
Yes.
Because Link Road, we had one of those narrow bridges, and it was always a problem. And you say it's going to be 18 feet from water line. Is that what I understood?
Yes, sir.
Will that be out of the flood?
That is the flood
way, yeah. Or will it still be in the flood?
The 100-year or the 1% probability occurrence flood, everything's underwater out there.
I know it is. That's what I've seen.
We simply can't afford. We use a 25-year storm event. We would, as a design, there's no way the county could afford to build.
Well, you'd have a road. You'd have a road another half mile long.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Further comments? Public comment? Motion?
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I move we award RFA 122-15, the bid for Wyman Road Bridge Replacement Contract, to King Construction Company for $356,245.
I second that.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Passes 5-0. Item number 8.
Recommendation of bid award to purchase hot mix patching, leveling, and surface course and profile milling for project number 15-5318.
This item for your consideration is to discuss and take appropriate action on a Saline County Road and Bridge Department request to award a contract for the furnishing of all tools, equipment, and labor required to provide countywide hot mix patching, leveling, and surface course and profile milling. This work is to be done at the locations designated in this request for action, and they're all listed there. I won't read them unless you want me to. Sealed bids were for project number 15-5318. Were opened on April 6th, and let's see here. We got one bid was received, and the total bid price was $1,314,990, which was less than the engineer's estimate of $1,423,200. So again, it being less than the engineer's estimate, according to Kansas statutes, we can you can award a contract if you deem appropriate. So the alternatives for action today are to accept the bids as indicated in the staff recommendation, reject bids and rebid, or other options. Staff recommends awarding a contract for project number 155318, hot mix patching, leveling, surface course, and profile milling to APAC Kansas Shears Division for $1,314,990. Award of this contract will also establish unit prices should the county have sufficient funds and elect to have additional work performed. The budget impact, as you recall, the sub-department 035 Road and Bridge contractual section of the 2015 Department 30 budget had a starting total of $1,926,970. Those dollars are set aside for doing work on asphalt road. On March 10th, the commission awarded contracts for project 155317, which was crack sealing, and project 155319, bituminous seal, and that encumbered of that $1,900,000, that encumbered $421,216. So the remaining amount in that account is $1,505,754. So if you elect to award this contract today to APAC for $1,314,990, we'll have a remaining amount of $190,764. This remaining amount will be held in reserve to cover unanticipated payment issues that may develop after harvest and over the summer months. And Commissioners Price and Guile can remember well that we had some issues on North Niles Road last year that we had to respond to, or basically we were going to lose parts of our pavement. So having a reserve is a good thing.
And it worked out real good.
Yeah.
How many miles are we talking about here that we're overlay or whatever?
Ooh, total.
Do you have any idea?
Not. I mean, this is the over this. They're all listed there. I don't remember the total off the top of my head.
Okay.
There's some of them are patched and some are leveled and some are actual overlays.
All right. Further questions or comments? Public comment? Thank you, Neil. Mm-hmm. Bring it back to the commission for action.
It kind of bothers me to get one bid.
Pardon me?
You only get one bid bothers me.
Yeah, it does. Us as well. In past years, I will say that we have gotten multiple bids. We there used to be more people in asphalt than there currently are. The other serious contender in this area is Schilling out of Manhattan, mm-hmm. Schilling Construction, and they have done work for Saline County. They actually, I think it was year before last, came in and underbid APAC. And the difficulty is with hot mix is that if you have a plant locally, it is hot mix, you know, and if you have to transport it distance from Manhattan, by the time you put it, it comes out of the out of their plant, and it's hauled all the way to Salina. You've got to contend with that issue of cooling over that distance.
56 miles.
Yeah, and part of the problem is that. It's really tough. What we ran into with Schilling, I'm probably saying more than you want me to, but the weather, if it's really marginal, the weather can change, you know, and they can start out from Manhattan with loaded up with asphalt to come. They're all set up to lay it down here and we can get a rain event. Mm-hmm. And that actually happened here a couple of years ago. So you got to make that judgment call whether to call it off for an afternoon and then you know, contractors don't really like to be told they can't do work. Hmm. So, But we agree, if there was another asphalt plant, there used to be more in Kansas, and, you know, it's kind of, they're falling out.
Was the old Blue and Blue, were they one that did it? And they went,
Brown and Brown.
Brown and Brown. Blue was.
And there's just less and less. Each year there used to be the outfit out of Wichita, and they did work up here. Mm-hmm. But they're no longer. We send it to all those people, you know, and there are ways to set up temporary plant sites, you know, but that's not cheap.
It's expensive.
They do it for KDOT for large paving projects, but not for our county work is kind of.
All right. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept RFA 141-15 and award the bid for project 15-5318 to APAC Kansas Inc. Shears Division for $1,314,990.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
There's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
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 Passes 5-0. Item point 9.
This is RFA 147-15. It's a sanitarian and sanitation department reorganization with David Neal, planning and zoning director, and Leanne Montoy, environmental health coordinator from the health department.
All right.
Morning, commissioners. If you'll recall from last week, we went over transferring two positions from the Environmental Health Division of the Health Department over to the Planning Department. We went over the services of the sanitarians that they provide. Basically, we presented two options for you. One option being no change. We leave them where they are. The service continues to be provided. The other option we provided shifts two of the positions over to the Planning Department. It also discusses the elimination of two half-time positions in the Health Department. Obviously, there are any option that the Commission, if you want to adjust these options, feel free to. We looked at some of the budget impact here. Obviously, if you're not changing anything, there's not going to be a budget impact. On the transferring, with the personnel for the 2015 budget, we would leave the budget where it is so that we just write the line items out as they use mileage. We just charge it out to that line item. For the 2016 budget, there would be no change as far as salaries, mileage, the supplies, things like that that the sanitarians are required to have. For the positions, I wrote each one separately for you. One of them is a half-time position for child care healthy home specialist. We wanted to put a end date. These positions are budgeted out for the end of 2015, but we did want to put an end date, so when you make your motion, please be sure to provide an end date. We're just going to recommend June as half the year. For the 2016, I wrote up annual savings. You would end up saving $22,757 on one position and $16,763 on the other. And then I wrote up the savings for 2015. If you're using the June date, you would end up with a half year salary savings, $11,378 and $8,381. As far as the juvenile center, relocating there, it was a little difficult to get any of the utilities there. 2013, the facility had been in full use. 2014, it was out of use. These having two people there is not going to run it in the same conditions that having an entire facility like that running. What I ended up doing was taking my best guess, which was taking some budget numbers in 2013, that was during full operation. Using that, I used winter numbers because we know the heating and cooling's gonna be a little higher in winter there. And the estimate came out to $10,193. I believe that's high, but I would rather overdo your numbers so that we aren't getting you anything wrong there. There is a potential increase on job descriptions as far as transferring work to myself and to my administrative assistant. That is something HR would have to look at and see if that reclassifies the position. I don't expect it would. I expect this is an increase in work, not a change in work, which is what would change that number. The numbers that I gave you for 6 and 7, for item 6, I am basically just giving you the annual 2016 numbers. It would be a total savings of $28,501. That's saying that the positions are funded all the way to December 31st this year. The savings for 2015, I'm going to include some of the one-time costs that are incurred for this year, and that is saying that the positions are ended June 31st. The savings would be $9,249. Looking at moving expenses, most of it can be handled with some help from the Expo Department getting all the physical moving done. The bigger costs that we looked at, making sure that they have a computer connection. We still have to work this out with IT to find the best way possible. We are just throwing out a rough estimate of $5,000 in case they have to hook up full network facilities over there. Obviously, if that comes down, that kind of money has to come in front of the commission to get approval, and I know Brad does a great job at finding the best way and the most efficient and portable way of getting that done. The one thing I did not include in that $9,000 savings was the installation of an exhaust fan. I don't have any estimates offhand. We would have to go bid that with contractors. I don't imagine that to be an expensive item. It could probably be done through a verbal bid. My rough guess would probably be somewhere in the $1,000 range. Phones, these guys are field workers. They're going to use cell phones, so there won't be any need to hook up a phone line out there. Any customer contact would come through the phone lines as well. And at this point, if Leanne has anything to add, do you want to add anything? Okay. We are available for questions.
Why can't they stay in the health department as far as location? I mean, why do you need to remodel the juvenile facility and move them there?
Well, I think basically if we change supervisors, it would be kind of awkward if they stayed in the health department. And with Neil, he can see straight out his window to see what's going on at the juvenile center. It'd be easier to keep track of them and the accessibility. So,
how often are they in that? Would they be in that building? Or yeah, you can probably answer that.
I can. I don't actually have a percentage of time, but it is weather and contractor driven, their work. They're coming on to their busy season, usually starts in March, sometimes earlier when we have nice weather, and runs usually through October. And David's correct, the majority of their time is spent in the field during those times.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I interrupted you, so.
Well, that location is just as far from where you are as this one. I don't understand why we need to have an additional building.
I want to ask, my mind's blank. Jason, where's your office at now? Is it where you were when you moved in, or?
Yes, it is, in the health department.
That's not a very adequate office, is it?
It's sufficient for the needs
it's
that I have.
It's pretty poor. I was in your office. It's pretty cramped.
Well, that was initially when I first moved there. But since then, after we've cleaned out some stuff and rearranged things, I've got plenty of space in my office. So
who's in Farmer's old office? Anybody or?
Not at present, no.
Mm. Well, we could be using that probably. But space is, you don't have a tremendous amount of space over there at the health department, right? I mean, it's adequate right now, but I mean, it's been, well, I know your office is pretty small. And I'm just saying, if it may be a possibility that the space will be used at the over there. And when you talk about the utility bill, we're keeping that heat up. Our utility bill's been pretty good anyway, hasn't it, Rita?
We've kept it heated and cooled.
So it's not going to be a lot more
cooling, but heated.
Utility bill. And I think once that a person's moved in over there, it wouldn't be as great as expensive as just an empty building, you know. And the remodeling would be a little bit, but it could be tried at at the other place.
I'm assuming we could put some of those thermostat controls where it would turn the heat down in the evenings and weekends too, where now we're constantly heating for the whole, you know, all week long.
One of the things at the health department, whenever I've been over there, parking's a little tough too. So people that go over there, it's tight, parking, you know.
One of the concerns you had that we brought up last week, and thank you for your presentations last week, that was very helpful, we thought maybe this would be better for the customer. Does the customer ever have to actually talk to them? I mean, would the clients or I call them customers, would they actually go over to the juvenile center, or is it all with your office and then they come over here? I was a little unclear.
As far
about
as customer
that.
Service, yes, they do have to talk, and we have to mention that the property owner is a customer, the contractor is a customer, that
right.
They serve multiple there, and they are constantly on the phone with them, from what Leanne tells me and everything else. As far as if we're moving them to the juvenile center, I would prefer all the customer interaction, if it's face-to-face, either do it out in the field working with people on their property or do it in my office. I would not want public going in and out of the juvenile center, because we do store, there's some equipment stored in there, there's some, a few different departments store things in that building.
The only concerns I had, or I think I brought up, is number one, I understand that the lab that these field sanitarians have is not very big at the health department, is that correct? But is it sufficient? You know, I asked, when we were upstairs, I said, is it the size of this room? And somebody said, no, it's like the size of a very, very small room. Is it sufficient for those sanitarians?
Yes, it is. And actually, you know, when originally the health department left the city county building and moved to that location, the sanitarians at that time had input into the space they need. It's a large kitchenette. The small kitchenette at the juvenile center is, if I were to guess, countertop space is more than, less than half that size.
That was what I needed to know. I wanted to know if they were losing space at the juvenile detention.
Countertop and cabinet space. Probably in the day room. Is that where you're thinking of locating them?
Probably. There's a larger kitchen area in the juvenile center.
It's been a long time since I've been in there. When I toured it.
Oh, touring.
Well, I toured it when I was on city commission. So I'm trying to visualize in my head where they're going to be placed.
Is it the day room? Is that what you're thinking?
I think that's the larger room.
The activity school.
Okay,
room, day
I remember
room.
That room. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And there's a small bank of upper and lower countertops. There's a sink.
Mm-hmm.
And like I mentioned, just as far as countertop and cabinet, it's a little less than half probably of what they currently have.
And then back to, because when it was under the health department's umbrella, part of your title, I believe, or part of your responsibilities, Jason, is you're the educator for everything that happens at the health department. Are we going to lose that piece when people want to know about what the health department does? We're losing the environmental piece, which is the sanitarium. So I just wondered how we were going to still let people know what we offer and what we do if it falls out from underneath your jurisdiction.
That is a subject that we've discussed, and we're not exactly sure how that's going to affect what, from the environmental health perspective, education-wise, because we are going to lose those two subject matter experts. And then it becomes an issue of, if we are doing something where it requires their input, it puts another step or two in the process of trying to get them and coordinate with them for that input, as opposed to having it in-house as the part of the core public health functions that we work with.
Right. I mean, is David going to be adding that piece of education when it comes to environmental health? Or is there going to be a crossover? I think that's important, so I don't want it to suddenly go away.
There would have to be some kind of crossover. Either I am using my time to educate people on environmental health as far as this is what's required, or like he said, if there's something that comes in between that the health department takes the lead on, then the sanitarians go work with the health department to solve those problems. Together as a county, we solve everything.
I think it's important to take into consideration that it's still in the county, and that, you know, county departments communicate, work together, so that flow shouldn't really be that much different than when they were actually out in the field and you had to call them in or what have you. So I think that can be worked out pretty easily to keep that flow of information going and cooperation.
But there's still a job description change, I assume. Doesn't it sound to me?
I'm hearing
there was much of a job description change.
Their services should remain the same.
Okay.
Yeah. I think there will be a little, but what I hear from Rita and David, though, is the intent is to leave those basic duties
right.
the same.
Right.
Of the sanitariums.
Correct.
Okay. The two part-time jobs that will be eliminated at the health department, we're not creating another job over in planning and zoning.
No.
Your assistant will handle, I take it, that one half.
Correct.
And then I believe there's going to be an extra or added portion to you because you'll become the head of the two sanitariums.
Correct. But
correct?
As far as job description stuff, yes, it will be extra work, but typically when you reclassify a job, there has to be new functions associated to it, not just added work.
Okay.
And I believe this
and
is
the
just...
the functions are staying the same, so...
I believe so.
Okay.
Jim, do you recall when they were wanting to build a new health building, they said that the old health department, it smelled, and that they needed more room for the sanitation? That was one... Oh, yeah. They made a pretty big... when they wanted the new building, that was one of the reasons they needed it, was the smell of the health department and the fact that they were, and it was tight. It's very tight over there where they were at. It's, have you ever been in and
yes,
to there?
Yes, when mm-hmm. we took the tour, and I'm trying mm-hmm. to remember where that little,
yeah, well,
where the lab would be.
It's environmental health has probably as much or more dedicated space for their job duties as the other departments within the health department.
Mm-hmm.
And they have an exhaust fan. My office is right there. And when we have a water sample that goes south, the fan goes on and the door shuts, and it is not an issue. I have not personally heard any complaints from any other staff in the building, and I sit right there 6 feet from it, and mm-hmm. it's not a problem. Environmental health is located when you come on the 7th Street entrance, that's the furthest south, which
mm-hmm.
takes you right by home health, and
mm-hmm.
if you just keep going straight, you end up the environmental health section.
Okay.
Any further questions before we open up to public comment?
Well, I'm in favor of the transfer of the duties to planning and zoning, but I don't see that we need to spend money on the building. I don't know why we can't leave the two people where they are.
All right.
We can discuss. We don't have to, with this motion, we don't have to make those changes right now, do we? We're just saying that we're taking the two positions
right.
from the Department of Planning to the zoning. We're not making any of those decisions yet at this time.
Is there public comment at this time?
Yes, Norman Mantle, West Pleasant Hill Road. This lady liaison seems to indicate that she's satisfied with adequate space. This gentleman over here, Mr. Teller, he seems to indicate he's satisfied with his space, so why are we spending more money foolishly?
Okay.
And my next question is, or comment is, we don't need to be eliminating health department employees. If anything, we could maybe eliminate some other department employee. Are we combining the health department and the planning department?
Doesn't sound to me like it at this time, no.
Well, then why is the planning director making the decisions on what's to be done? Why don't we have a director from the health department asking for requests?
We haven't done anything yet, and that's why we're asking for public comment. But
well, that's what I want to comment. So we could eliminate maybe the planning department and let the health department expand.
All right. Thank you.
Karen Shade, 111 Wisconsin. One of the things I need to get clear right off, because maybe I've misinterpreted this, is planning and zoning moving into the juvenile detention center as well with the sanitarians, or is it just the sanitarians moving?
At this point, it's just the sanitarians moving, but it is up to the commission to give some direction as far as office space.
Okay. All the time I've assumed planning and zoning was moving, and I guess not. So that's not, wasn't exactly clear in the RFA. I've lived in communities that have had issues with rabies, rabid animals, plague, hantavirus in this region, Lyme disease, West Nile, and the complications of, say, bird flu or the diseases that the farm animals might get, and the concerns of whether they're contagious to humans, have always occupied some of the sanitarians' time. So I didn't really see that mentioned in the RFA, and I'm wondering how that public health emergency issue would be addressed.
Would either one of you like to tackle that?
I would say as soon as we become aware of an emergency, there is a public health, I forget the exact title, emergency officer. Once that emergency becomes in place, the sanitarians go directly to work for them no matter what, because that is an emergency. It's a problem the county would have to solve. You don't want to have, you want one person in charge, and in case of environmental disaster, in case of disease, any of these things, the state is clear that the environmental health officer, the emergency management officer, does that stuff.
And currently, Jason, doesn't that fall under your responsibility?
Sir.
Yes, okay.
All diseases.
Yes, public health emergency preparedness is part of my job description. So with that being said, I guess if this move does occur, then we would need to make sure that it is very clear the, as far as public health emergencies, roles and responsibilities, who they report to.
One of the other issues that as I was thinking about it and reflecting on the conversation here is that back in 2012, 2013, 2014, when the roof of the health department collapsed, it was
believed. It didn't collapse. It was just.
Okay, it went. Well, when the roof became problematic, the decisions then were that environmental health should be in that building space, and there was some construction and there was some remodeling or whatever to keep them there, even though parking was tight and all of the other, you know, office space might have been problematic. It's a little bit of a turnaround that they've only occupied that space for 10 months, and now there's discussion about moving them. And that's just a little bit hard for me as a taxpayer to kind of wrap my head around. Going through the budget impact of what was written up here, under the elimination of the child care home health specialist, it said that it was budgeted for December 31st, and this had to do, I think, with the radon grant?
The Healthy Homes? The Healthy Homes Specialist is part of the CARE grant.
Okay. So, but I thought last week I heard that was going to end in September 30th?
Correct. Let me explain that position a little better. Originally, that was a half-time child care surveyor position. When I moved to environmental health and gave half my time to managing that program, we hired a half-time position to take up some of my responsibilities in child care. That employee then, during our CARE grant, had the opportunity to work more hours on top of the child care piece, being a healthy home specialist. And so the CARE grant is over in September, and those are additional hours on top of the half-time position for child care licensing. Okay.
Right, and so if that CARE grant ends in September, then to my way of thinking, the savings for 2015 are overstated, because that position would only, that carryover of that position wasn't even planned beyond September 30th. Is that correct?
CARE grant dollars are not contained within the RFA.
Okay.
So that the dollars associated with that position are childcare licensing dollars. Those are what you see there.
I understand that that radon money or that grant money was paying for the extra time that, that she put in. Is
correct.
That correct?
That yeah. is correct.
So in looking at this part two of option two, do you feel that the savings for 2015 will still be $11,378, or would you insert a different figure in there?
Well, it all would depend on when the elimination of the positions occurred,
okay.
which I believe David reflects, and as I mentioned, care dollars aren't reflected in here, so that 11 is just half of that salary. The care dollars are pay as you go, for
right.
lack of a better word. We get reimbursed as we spend the money. And so, for lack of a better word, it's kind of a wash. We make a little bit of money on it with indirect, but it's a wash, whereas some of these other programs are not. They're grant funded partially, the county funds the other part, et cetera. Am I answering your question?
Well, my biggest concern is that the commissioners understand this, because I might struggle with it a little bit. Under option two, number four, the current utility costs, including gas, electric, water, are approximately $1,704. Is that annual, or is that weekly, or is that monthly?
That was... I believe I pulled that from the 2014 budget. The difficulty in the juvenile center, 2014, the center wasn't operating, so the utility bills were naturally low. There was also some credit to Westar that they had to pay to the county, so there were some okay. electric bills that we didn't have to pay. So it was a little difficult to come up with a good average. That's why I used a 2013 January number to make that final $10,000 average.
Okay. Under one-time costs, one of the things I don't see, a couple of things I don't see here, is the moving time, because if the building's used for storage right now, that's a lot to get space emptied out, even though I do understand that the Expo Center does an excellent job, but and keeps costs minimal. The other costs not attributed might be for signage, letterhead, business cards, permits, those kind of things where these are legal documents, and to ink out a change of address might look bad. So I can see some additional costs there. As I think about this, I come at this in a totally different point of view, in the sense of, if you have two part-time administrative people who are working with the environmental health, and you can eliminate these positions, I always wonder what was going, who was stepping in to fill the breach, and how busy were they that they all of a sudden can take up part of this slack? Because the sanitarians have to be fairly expensive people. They're mobile. So you really don't want to use their time doing office work. So I have to kind of wonder what was going on there. And then I have my biggest frustration is that, and there's snippets of this, it goes back to December 30th and those kind of events, where all of this has been created to give David Neal something to do. And that, as a taxpayer, just sends me loopy. When I look at what David Neal's charge is, as best I can tell, you have four new planning and zoning members, and you're gonna have one new person on the appeal board. There's been an ask from the public, and the community has asked for a different style of meetings to allow more input and those kind of things. There might be a need to walk new members through the process of taking a concern and creating a code and bringing that code to the board. There's going to be a lot of those things to be done. And when I hear, and I think it's a valid discussion, because this is what I hear here on Access TV, that there is a rightful question about whether the UDC should come back or not. What I really hear them asking about is they want the index from the UDC, not so much the UDC code itself, but they want the index. And I don't know if that's proprietary information. I don't know if it requires software. I don't know if it requires a class or training. But it seems to me like David Neal has got plenty to do with what he's doing. So I kind of come back to Commissioner Smith's question. Why are we making this move? I really don't see that administrative savings. If there is a need to reduce administrative assistance, either in the health department or in planning and zoning, do that. If that's the true nature of what this issue is, it just doesn't make a lot of sense to me in terms of appearances. I do not know the content of what the sanitarians do and those kind of things. But when I look at appearances, it just does not look right from a taxpayer's point of view.
Karen, can I say something real quick? Evidently, David feels that he can handle this or he wouldn't have gone to all this work.
Right.
Second of all, the public is who we're concerned about, that they can come in and get things done easily, more available to them, take care of the public, be a service to the public. I think we've come to the point that we can save tax dollars on this. And I think the personnel will work better together. Things aren't working good right now.
Well,
so there's more reason this than what we're doing than what you're just saying.
Right.
It's to serve the public and keep it on a good relationship.
And so. my biggest concern, if the concern is public service or ease of use, you're going to set two sanitarians aside in a building that, and they're gone 70, 80, 90% of the time. So most of the time you're going to have the public showing up, banging on the door, going, you know, where are they? If there is no administrative assistant there.
I put in a well and a septic tank in the last 10 years. My first thing I did was I went over there and applied. Matter of fact, first we called, and it was in Ottawa County, so we called Ottawa County. Then we went over there and did our application.
Planning after, zoning.
Yeah, yes, no, not to planning and zoning. It was in Ottawa County, so it was just for the.
Okay.
And then from that point on, Joe and Farmer made all the visits.
Mm-hmm.
And all I did was call a number, I don't know what it was, but within an hour to 3 hours after I called, they were out there. And I never. When I had a problem, I got on the phone. I didn't come to town and say, hey, come do this. I need that. No, they come to you, and they get paid mileage, and we pay $300 now. Isn't that correct, Leanne? $300 is what it costs to do a septic tank? Yes. So we're not, the taxpayers are not paying for that. Tom, you know what I'm talking about.
But so. Going back to clarify, when you made your first phone call, Did you get a hold of a person or an answering machine?
No, you talked to a person.
But no, there will be no person over at juvenile detention if the two sanitarians.
No, that's not who you call. You call the secretary. They get a hold of the person.
So technically, planning and zoning secretary
might be the person that people call. After the first contact, after that point, you had their cell number and you called. I called Joe is who I called. Now she might have sent somebody else out. But Joe, she was the, and now we have sanitation in Ottawa County. There's one guy that handles that. There's another guy that handles Lincoln. It works very well.
Okay.
So that's, now maybe somebody in the public would have another comment on how it works. But.
Okay.
Thank you very much for your comments. Further public comment? I'll bring it back to the commission and I'll, if it's okay, Commissioner Smith, I got a question. It sounds to me like you'd be supportive of transferring the duties, and but keeping them there.
Yes.
Would you be supportive of, if there becomes a problem later on, the supervision type of problem, would you be agreeable to looking at moving something further down the line?
Sure.
You're just, what I hear you saying is, this is a little too quick to move them. Your gets the expense, I assume.
Right. Don't spend the money if we don't need to.
Okay.
See if we need to.
But you would be willing to later on down the line, if it seemed to be a problem,
sure,
look at that.
Sure.
Well, and Mr. Chair, in fairness, my explanation is I'm worried about the piece that is not going to be there that falls under the health department education, under environmental health. And that's why I was asking who's going to be, you know, it's no longer under Jason's umbrella. So it's obviously going to be under Mr. Neal's. And I'm just worried about losing environmental health under a health department umbrella. Mm-hmm. So
Well, I'm worried about losing it the way it is right now. So you can look at it both ways.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Last week, I was in Manhattan, Kansas, and I was talking to Bert, which they transferred their people, their sanitariums, out of the health department, which it works very well. There's only three of them over there run the whole situation of the sanitary health and planning. It's planning also.
I believe so.
Yep. It's in their planning and planning, and it isn't zoning. I can't remember what he called it, but it's not planning and zoning.
Riley
planning.
County is a little different because they have Manhattan has a joint planning county thing.
Mm. Yeah, they just don't call it zoning all.
Yeah.
But it is the planning board, and they operate that way so they can do their sanitary, like say the septic systems, the water treatment and all that. Just wanted to let you know that I was there last week.
And how's that working for you?
It's working great. It's like you talk, it's dollar savings.
And that's all they do, however.
Yeah.
In the majority, as I mentioned last week, in all those counties where it left the health department, the basic work is all that is completed. Those other environmental programs eventually went away, and that's our concern.
Yeah. They run the dump. They run everything, anything to do with sanitation.
Well, I'm supportive of the move for two reasons, the cost savings, and I think customer service would be improved. You know, anytime that the customer only has to call one office, that makes sense to me. I am sympathetic, though, however, to your cost,
mm-hmm.
Commissioner Smith, and maybe that makes sense to delay that a little bit. Lucy, I don't know how to alleviate your concerns. I don't have an answer for that. It might be something that we continue to look at. I do feel a little bit better that we all are county employees, and
right.
It's my assumption that we're all going to be concerned about what's best for the citizens, and you know, hopefully that if this passes, that the groups work together to make sure somehow that continues. But I do understand your concerns.
If they put a well in the city, do they go out and inspect that or
no?
Who does that?
We can mm-hmm. test well water, but that's out of our
jurisdiction. Does the city require an inspection when a well's
for
put
a
in
yard
the city?
Well? Mm-hmm.
As far as I remember the statutes, when I've read through them, the cities are not subject to the sanitary codes that the state puts out. So if a city wants to create their own inspection system, they can do that.
We don't do that, though.
I don't know if Salina does or not.
But they are in the county.
Well, I would like to make a motion to resign with comment.
Yeah, let's make sure it's fairly specific, because I think we maybe have changed it a little bit.
Well, let me make it. I'd say, Mr. Chairman, I move that we transfer the two sanitary positions from the health department to planning and zoning. And at this point, we leave the space for the two positions in the health department until we make a later decision.
Going back to an earlier conversation, you wanted it to be specific about
if
the
you
time
are
frame.
Oh, and correct. And you think June? You think we could be the 1st of May? Do you think it has to be the 1st of June? I think the quicker we do this, the better it'd be for the help.
I'm going to leave that to Leanne,
mm-hmm.
because the more help we have in
right.
transitioning this, it.
So what do you think, Leanne, on that? June or May?
Are you asking about the transfer the date, or the elimination the date. Of the positions?
No, I think the elimination, was okay. The elimination.
The elimination of the positions. Mm-hmm. My recommendation is to leave them until the end of the year. They're mm-hmm. in the budget.
But would you, if we did June or May, which would you prefer?
For the elimination of the mm-hmm. positions? Mm-hmm. If those are my two options, the end of June.
End of June. Another question, too, is that, or another thing that I might add to this is we may have to discuss paying some of the utilities at that location. Well, I guess it's county
it's
anyway.
County
it's all
anyway.
County anyway.
It's all
so.
County. All well, the same.
Okay, we'd work that out about the move at another time.
Yes. Okay, so if I'm understanding your motion right, you're transferring the two sanitation positions from the health department to the planning and zoning department.
As of June 1st.
No.
No. I mean,
June 30th.
June 30th. Oh, okay, June 30th.
June 30th.
Okay.
With the elimination of...
The transfer
The transfer is going to happen immediately.
Okay, the transfer. Okay.
The transfer okay. happens immediately. The motion says
the termination
that
the of the
termination.
Position would be June 30th.
The last, last day would be June 30th.
And at this time, we're going to stay in the location we're at.
I will be supportive of that after a second. Well, actually, I'd like to have a second first, then I'll make my comments. Is there a second to that?
I'll second that.
I'll be supportive of this motion with the understanding that we need to look later on and see if the location's working. And I would like a further review of this, maybe in 6 months, to see, you know, how things are going. I don't want to lose those services, and I want to make sure that the groups are working together to make sure that we continue our services for our taxpayers. But other than that, I'll be supportive of that. There is a motion and a second. Is there further comment? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
It passes 4-1. All right. Item number 10.
Juvenile Statistics Monthly Update with Lieutenant Sean Kokanowski of the Sheriff's Office.
Lieutenant.
Good afternoon. Sorry I didn't get these documents to you, so they were in your packets before you. This is the first time you've got to see them today. But the first sheet that you have just has all the months of the year there. You see that in March we had 19 kids that were totally booked into the system in some way or another. Most of those were probation violations, community intervention program violators. The next sheet is the 2015 juvenile center information. It shows you that our March average stay was right about the typical 15 days. Average per day was 10.61. Average age was 15.58. That's typically a pretty consistent number that we see. We had 27 kids for court and 17 trips to Junction City. So our trips are staying right there around that 20 number, which has been pretty much what it's been. The last sheet that you have, the one that's sideways there, just kind of shows you what it was every day for the month of March.
Questions?
I was over there last Wednesday,
mm-hmm.
and the numbers are sometimes low and sometimes high.
That's typical for juvenile detention.
I know it is. And I know that they're taking a look at a lot of things over there. And
yeah.
But I think we've got them in order, we hope.
Hopefully.
Yep.
It seems to be working really well over there.
Yeah,
so.
It is. It really works smooth over there.
Yeah.
And I see that we lost one of them over there.
Yeah.
Any further comments? Public comment? Lieutenant, thank you for your patience for
thank
waiting
you.
This long, and appreciate you being here.
Not a problem.
Thank you. Item number 11.
Have a department report from the health department with Jason Tiller, public health educator.
Good afternoon, commissioners. I will be updating you on public health emergency preparedness, one of the two programs at the health department that I manage. So the purposes of FEP is to be able to look at all hazards planning from a public health perspective and to mitigate and take actions to minimize any issues when those arise. So either from a disease perspective or from the incidence of a disease outbreak that occurs after a natural disaster, such as a tornado, and then you have to worry about tetanus and other type of diseases. We also look to build community resilience in order for the community to get back to normal as soon as possible. A lot of that is through improvement of community health so that it makes them less susceptible to the diseases during an outbreak. We look at building organizational and individual capacity to survive incidents through preparation, training, and education. And in addition, we also coordinate functions of the support or emergency support function aid for health and medical task force to include mental health and mass fatality response. As you can see, public health starts with the health department, and then we have our individual agencies within the health department. These agencies, though, do not operate just on standalone silos, because public health does not, and emergency preparedness does not operate in a vacuum. We need others in order to be able to accomplish everything from the preparation standpoint. So as we move through it, each of these sub-departments within the health department build a network of increasing strength and capabilities in order to be able to respond to outbreak incidents, as well as to improve public and community health, population health, in order to increase that resiliency, especially in dealing with vulnerable populations that some of our agencies see, like dealing with the elderly, dealing with children, who are usually the ones that are first impacted by disease outbreaks in communities. And you can see there also that the health department, in building that network with other organizations such as the Emergency Support Function 8, the Healthcare Coalition through Salina Regional Healthcare, North Central Emergency Preparedness, Central Kansas FEP, building those networks, building that web increases the strength of our ability to be able to respond to disease outbreaks and also to be able to take care of and monitor during natural disasters for any type of disease, health-related incidents after that. So these next couple slides are just some of the recent public health threats that have been in the news, and we have been lucky so far that we have not had any actual incidents here in Saline County. There have been, and they're just about finished now, three people that had returned, three missionaries that were under surveillance that had come back from Africa for going through the three-week Ebola surveillance, and they've had no signs or symptoms. But as far as actual disease incidents, there has not been anything here so far. Same thing with pertussis. We've been lucky so far with the whooping cough not to have any. There have been some that were suspected, but once testing was complete, it was confirmed that it was not whooping cough. And no confirmed or reported cases of listeria from Bluebell ice cream in the area in Saline County either at this time. Those types of diseases, if they were to show up and start spreading throughout the community, then we would take additional actions in order to monitor, and we'll cover that in a minute. One of the big ones we did see recently, though, a lot of was influenza. If you'll remember several articles in the paper recently in the last few months during this flu season of Salina Regional having to close its doors to a certain point because all their beds were full. And that is a very real possibility for any other type of disease outbreaks that have the potential for a large impact. As part of the emergency preparedness, you can see here in this little graphic that if disease outbreak occurs, most of the hospital and surrounding medical facilities are going to be focused on treating those ill patients and those that believe they may have or exhibiting some sort of illness. They'll be collecting data, and they're also going to have many other ill patients, emergencies, cardiac arrest, heart attacks, crash victims that they're going to be dealing with. A lot of the surveillance, or most of the surveillance, really falls to the health department. So even though the medical facilities have nurses, doctors, and that kind of such, they're going to be solely focused on treatment. The health department and the emergency preparedness, and as part of our policies and procedures that we continue to improve on, managing an isolation, quarantine of exposed victims, monitoring for new cases. We do that on a consistent basis. Contact investigations for any type of reported diseases, even for routine stuff like hepatitis B, hepatitis C, educating the public. Part of it also is in emergency preparedness is to be able to analyze all that data that is being collected at the different hospitals and medical facilities, and then trying to correlate to, are we in a reaching an epidemic? Is this something where we need to start looking at additional state and federal resources, initiating mutual aid agreements, et cetera? And then providing mass vaccinations or medications as part of a mass dispensing programs. So some of the updates at this point is that we've been working on the emergency operations plan internally for the health department, and I have a copy of it here if you wish to see that afterwards. That pretty much covers most of the incidents that we would likely encounter from fire, tornadoes, bomb threats, et cetera. Continuing to build our coalition and capabilities with ESF8 partners, as well as the Healthcare Coalition and our Central Kansas Public Health Emergency Preparedness. Also looking at all of our standard operating guides. They are on a general 5-year cycle to where they are completely updated and reviewed, even though they do each get an annual review to make sure that they're current. At this point, with my recent taking over of many of these, that we are doing a complete review of all of them, which takes time to get into the details to make sure that everything is current and up to date, with the much of the knowledge that my predecessor took with them when they retired, to just make sure that we are ready for any type of incident. For future projects, one of them tonight is a pilot for a emergency preparedness planning for child care facilities. This, there are online classes available that covers this material. However, this so far, and we've had a couple counties that Wyandotte and Riley County that have expressed interest in what we're doing, because there's not a program out there that actually does a in-classroom interactive class on preparedness planning and dealing with the intricacies that child care facilities have to deal with, like planning for how many children they have and how they're going to create kits and how they're going to be able to evacuate them and that kind of those topics. We're also got personnel that would be going through mental health first aid, which will increase our ESF8 capabilities and be able to identify those in crisis during an emergency response. Developing robust development. Some of the things that we've talked about the other day in our ESF8 meeting is increasing our capabilities of identifying and being prepared for vulnerable populations. So elderly, mentally ill, disabled, as well as the mass fatality of being prepared in the event that, say, a large tornado or something moves through and there are many deceased, and how we deal with those and do that respectfully. Community Disaster Response Symposium will be coming up in June. That is something that has been myself, along with many of the other volunteer organizations that are active in disasters, such as the Red Cross and the Medical Reserve Corps and Solana Regional Hospital Emergency Management, have developed a 2-day symposium specific for volunteer organizations and what their roles and responsibilities are in disaster management. And from a public health emergency preparedness perspective, we're really looking at the social media aspect of what they do, how to manage that, and how to get the right messages out to the public instead of everybody just taking 100 selfies at the disaster site or the outbreak site. And then the second day we'll follow with a small exercise out at Crisis City, where they will have a scenario and actually be able to set up and conduct their operations of the different organizations. It's been an exciting event. We've got quite a few people that have signed up for it so far. We've spoken earlier about the Ebola grant, which will allow us to purchase the equipment and conduct the training for dealing with Ebola and other type of diseases of that same nature. We'll be working on that over the next 18 months for some long-term sustainability. And then we're starting some planning. Coming up in September will be National Preparedness Month. So at this point right now, we don't have much more than just a couple of ideas, but we want to be able to have consistent conversation, activities, and things like that focused throughout that month on preparedness, especially from the public health perspective. At this time, are there any questions? Oh, I'm sorry, I have one more slide, and then I have questions. So, stewardship of our FEP grant funds, because it is completely grant funded. So at this point, in the last 4 months, I've attended 7 in-residence trainings. The only cost that was associated with those was just the mileage, because some of them were either in Topeka, Emporia, and other places throughout the state. We have received multiple boxes of preparedness-related material from FEMA at no cost, such as brochures, posters of that nature. And we're able to outsource the printing of our emergency operations plan to a high school design development class. And so they were able to print these essentially at cost at about $5 a piece for us. So that saves some of our FEP funds that we can be able to put towards more important either training materials for the community improvement. Now, if there are any questions.
Nice presentation, appreciate it. Questions? Very good, is there any public comment? Thank you, Jason, for being here. Appreciate it very much. Item number 12.
County Appraiser's Monthly Update with Cheryl Sammons, our County Appraiser.
Hi, Cheryl.
Good morning, Commissioners, or afternoon, yes. I should say. I think that my PowerPoint will get...
It's coming.
The annual cycle of appraisers' duties, in our office, we think of it as final review as is the beginning, and that's sort of a juxtaposition, final review at the beginning of the year. But we set values on properties every year based on what is there January 1st. Notices are mailed March 1st, and after the notices are mailed, then the homeowners and property owners have an opportunity to appeal values in what's known as the informal appeal process. This year we had 321 hearings that were scheduled. Out of those, we've had changes to 189 and no changes to 73. That's a 72% change for those that come in for hearings. Sometimes we do hear that we don't change the values, but we do. This is a little more than normal. It's usually about 6%. We have some new appraisers, and their choices right now indicate a higher amount of change than in the past. We still have about 49 parcels that have not been determined yet or not been mailed. So if you're wondering why 189 and 73 don't add up. There were 8 cancellations on hearings this year, and there were 2 that were no-shows, and that occurs just about every year. We are moving into the personal property phase, and our staff has been very busy working the renditions that have come in. March 15th is the deadline to file personal property each year. Personal property by its nature is mobile and self-reporting by statute. The penalties accrue at 5% a month. And so I urge those that have personal property to bring their renditions in and get them filed so they don't accrue more penalties. We will be mailing out personal property valuations the first of this next month. Lots of types of personal property there. We're also beginning our recollect phase. Our appraisers currently are finishing up their hearing folders. We have started in the community with a rent survey going door to door for commercial type rentals, that is five or more units on a property. Our people will visit with a manager of the property first if it's a complex or a large unit. If they're unavailable, they'll go ahead and knock on doors to get rent surveys. That's followed out later in the year, probably in the next few weeks, with mailings to the owners of the properties for an opportunity to give us income and expense information. This information is used in our database to determine values for apartment type properties. Every year we contact different types of property owners for income and expense information to be able to utilize it in our analysis. We gather quite a bit of it from hearings and from websites and appraisals, anywhere we can get it, ads in the newspaper. What it's for rent for. This year, the residential appraisers are going to be working in four townships to begin with: Greeley, Solomon, Walnut, and Eureka. That green's a little hard to see on there, but it's east and southeast of the city. These areas have not been data collected in a timely fashion, and so it's time we get out there. That includes the cities of Kip and Gypsum. And I want you to know this looked really great on my screen, and it's squished or something here, and we're dropping a letter here and there. Truly, I tell you, it is just fine on my printout. The commercial properties that will be looked at this year are the third tier of townships, and that's Spring Creek, Washington, Smolin, Walnut, and Eureka. It will include Kip and Gypsum as well as Brookville, Smolin, and Mentor. So our appraisers will be in this rural area this year. Something new that we're going to be doing is putting this information on our website so that people can see where we are. In this day and age, people are often a little leery of someone driving around. And I want you to be aware that our appraisers have a tire that identifies them. They have a yellow safety vest. In addition to the vest, it is labeled on their Saline County Appraiser's Office. They will have their county ID on them at all times, as well as the obligatory tape measure and clipboard. So they do use their own cars. We do not have county vehicles for the appraiser's office, and appraisers are reimbursed mileage. So we do not have identified cars, but when they get out of the car, it's pretty easy to discern that they're with our office.
Comment on that. Wouldn't a magnetic sign on their car be a help?
That's something that we have tried. When we get out on the highways, they have flown off. And we had, I think we're down to one. At one time, everybody had one about 25 years ago when I came here. But they were found in ditches or not at all. It just was not satisfactory and you had to have two per vehicle. So it would, ultimately, it didn't work out very well. Mm-hmm. I'd like to talk for a minute about upper level hearings, because after the informal process or the payment under protest process, at the end of the year, people have an opportunity to appeal further to more levels, the Small Claims Division of the Board of Tax Appeals, and then the full board. Currently, the Small Claims Division handles properties at less than $3 million. We have two hearings on the schedule for this month, and we don't have any Board of Tax Appeals hearings this month, but we do have three coming up in May and June. Gee, this is kind of a hot topic right now, what's been going on with the legislature. My main item that I'll speak on today is Senate Bill 178, the ag use valuation. You have heard that there's talk and work in SB 178 of changing agricultural land from ag use to market value. And if you have read any articles about it, it would be a huge difference for farmers and agricultural owners. When this bill was first brought out, it was in the Ways and Means Committee, and it was set for hearing when it was abruptly halted and moved over to taxes and assessment and taxation. It has yet to be heard, but we're getting ready to come back Wednesday, April 29th, with what's commonly known as the veto session, not necessarily meaning that they're going to veto items from Governor Brownback, but it is a very hard-working, you might even say heavy-lifting session, and many times they will group bills together. We do not know what will occur. A couple of the other things we're looking at it in assessment and taxation. One is a clear definition of substantial and compelling. When values are rolled currently, if you receive a reduction in a hearing, you will receive that same value for 2 years as per legislative changes last year. And substantial and compelling was very quantifically defined as an increase in square foot on the property. And the Kansas Association of Counties and the Kansas Association of Appraisers, Kansas County Appraisers Association, it is our opinion that when a home is in extreme disrepair and has gone in and completely remodeled, that that is substantial and compelling. So we'll see if the legislature looks at that. The other item is one that Don can address as well. For many years with appraisal, 20 school meals have been set aside and deducted, that amount deducted from the residential tax bill. It amounted to $46. And there is talk to put that back in place. Again, we don't have an answer for that, but that'll probably be dealt with in the veto session. We're going to know more when they come back, but a lot of what I have read about depended on the report yesterday that came out. And it is reported in the Hover report, which I subscribe to, which gives me information on what's going on in the Capitol, that there will be somewhere near $210 million new spending cuts and tax increases in addition to what we did have at the state level. So whether any of these things I've just talked about come to fruition, I don't know. As far as the ag bill, they've been hit really hard, our legislators, by Farm Bureau and other lobbying entities to not change it. Ag use value is currently about 10% of market value, and one of your commissioners can attest to that. We'll see what happens. I really don't look for movement on it this year, but it is not gone. It will come back. And if they were to change the assessment level on it, that would have to be done constitutionally, a vote by the public. So, short story is, we have to find it. We have to assess what's there. And you build it, and we'll come.
Thank you for the slideshow. Appreciate it. Any questions?
I have a comment. Since 74% of the appeals had a lowering of their taxes, nobody appealed to get it higher, right?
No. We did have appeals to make it higher.
Really?
It happens every year. Yes, the vast majority are to have it lowered.
Yeah, okay.
Make their net worth or get ready to sell it. Or yeah.
then I think it is imperative on you and your staff to make sure you don't over-appraise properties, particularly on lower valued properties, because people are intimidated and not willing to come in and challenge your figure. And they'll just pay that tax year after year, realizing it's too high, but afraid to do anything about it. So I think it's on an obligation on your department to not over-appraise houses.
By statute, we are to appraise at market value, and that is what we strive for. The methodology that we use to find market value is to derive from the market what the age of a home, the square footage, the number of bedrooms, the number of baths,